Tuesday, 6 o'clock. This must be Tuesday, it's the 6th. Welcome. Little housekeeping before I introduce tonight's speaker. This meeting house is always in need of some kind of maintenance or repair. And to that end, we've set up a fishbowl out by the front door. A little box here if you try to escape that way. Any loose change, bills, folding money, checks, credit cards, as long as you have the PIN number, you're written on the back, that would be appreciated. And as you, one other thing, as you look through the your brochure, I want you to note some of the advertisers in there. They've been very generous for their contribution to the Falls Village Canaan Historical Society this year. And we really wish anytime you stop in there that you mention you've seen their ad. And do a lot of business. Okay, tonight's speaker. For those of you who were here last week, you may recall we had a little trouble with the sound system, a little panic. Tonight's speaker does not require a sound system. Lou is not exactly my next door neighbor, but when he's outside and talking, he's at least right next door. Lou and his wife Sue, and his daughters, his grandson, and Polo, the wonder dog, been a very positive addition to Ainesville, which I just want to stress one more time, we had Falls Village before anybody else did. Remember that. Okay. Those of you who picked up the Lakeville Journal last week may have noticed an imposing figure on the front page. Tonight's speaker, a great educator, good neighbor, good friend, Lou the Chair.
When I saw that picture last Thursday, I almost called Patrick Sullivan and asked him if he could have gotten just a little closer. I hope that the Lakeville Journal circulation numbers for last week didn't go down rather dramatically. So, yes. I have an interesting story to tell about how this topic came to be. Those of you who have come to my talks before know that I've always focused on historic topics, biographies, stories of one kind or another that related to people, connected with people. And today's subject is a little bit different. When Judy Jacobs came and asked what my topic was going to be months ago, I mentioned to her that I was going to do something on historic preservation. And there was a pause. And then she said, "It's okay, you can tell me when you're ready to decide." And I said, "No, Judy, really, it's going to going to be about historic preservation. Lulu, it really is okay. If you want to wait a few more days to tell me what you're going to talk about, we still have some time before we put it into the program. She didn't really believe me up until the time the program actually had to be published, and I finally convinced her. The reason why I'm talking about this is really professional. I teach 7th and 8th grade social studies at Salisbury Central School. And one of the things that we ask our 8th graders to do is a culminating project at the end of their 8th grade year. Now it's not. I know it. There we go. Okay? Salisbury Central is not unique in this project idea. In fact, we stole the idea from Amy Lake, who teaches middle school social studies at the H. Kellogg School here in Falls Village. But Jenny Law in particular, who teaches 8th grade English and literature at Salisbury Central, thought this really would be a nice way for 8th graders to bring all of the skills they've learned through their elementary years together, and to make a connection to the community. To really give them a real world application of their learned skills. To essentially find the soapbox, something, an issue that they had a passion for, that interested them, something where they couldn't say, why are we learning this? They had the reason right before them to find the soapbox. There we go. And to get up on it. To actually tell the world about their passion. To try and make a difference. And there were several different parts to it. There we go. And it connects to the community. There are several different parts to it. One was a thesis paper. No, I'm not going to have you read my thesis paper. Don't worry. But the more exciting part of the project for me has always been the dissemination. How do the students give their knowledge, show their passion to the rest of the world? And that's what I'm doing tonight. And then finally, there's an exposition where all of the 8th graders get dressed up. That's part of the grading of it. They get dressed up. They have a three-fold or two-fold cardboard display that they've created. They can have other items there to help give their message out. And they gather together in the cafeteria. And then people from the public, as well as people from school, come through and they learn more about their topic. The dissemination piece is separate from the exposition. And students can use lots of different methods of dissemination. Some students write letters to the editor. If you're a faithful reader of the Lakeville Journal, long about springtime, you start seeing letters to the editor from Salisbury Central 8th graders. That's their dissemination project. Others of you who attend lectures at Scola Library might have seen on a couple of occasions in the last couple of years, 8th graders who give lectures very much like this one. They create public service announcements that they then send to WHTV or out of the radio or to the public access television station. There are lots of different ways to disseminate. Well, last fall, the three teachers who coordinate the 8th grade project, Jenny Law, I mentioned, John Conklin, who teaches 7th and 8th grade science, and myself, were gathered together trying to figure out the logistics for the project, set up the dates, go over, tweak whatever needed to be tweaked, and I don't remember who it was, it wasn't me. suggested that there should be a model project, that someone should create a model project for eighth graders to look at the beginning, to see what the project entailed. And both Jenny and John looked at me and said, "Lou, you always do those presentations at Stovall Library on Tuesdays at 6. That would be a great dissemination project. You're always doing stuff with the Historical Society. Could you do model this project?" And I, of course, was sort of stumped because, yeah, I could do it. And yes, they need it. And so this is part of that effort to model the eighth grade project. So this is the dissemination. My thesis has to do with historical preservation. Little background on historic preservation in the United States. The movement did begin in Great Britain in 1880, and it came to this country in the late 19th century, down in Virginia particularly. It really gained momentum in the last half of the 20th century. The federal government in 1949 signed into legislation an act that created the National Trust for Historic Preservation. In the 1960s, historic preservation became a component of local planning and zoning, and the movement really took off during the mid-60s. The real catalyst for it all was all of the conversation, all of the debate, all of the controversy that surrounded the demolition of New York's Pennsylvania Station. When they were getting ready to build the new Madison Square Garden down in Midtown. Organizations came about overnight, grew overnight, to try and oppose the demolition. As we all know, ultimately they were unsuccessful, but it began the momentum to historic preservation, to trying to understand good things about the past so that they could be preserved for the future in lots of different ways. And not just buildings either, but ideas, stories, memories. Well, why? Why do we bother? Why do we try to connect to the past? God, I'm preaching to the choir in a certain way. You really probably, I'm guessing, wouldn't be here if you didn't have an interest in history to begin with. But the idea of preservation has a great hold on people's psyche. And I offer this example, which I read about on a blog that's run by that's run out of the University of Kansas. It's called the Community Toolbox. And back in, I want to say, 4 years ago, 2008, a man by the name of Phil Rabinowitz wrote an article called Encouraging Historic Preservation. And this is the example that he gave for encouraging historic preservation. When the former Czechoslovakia overthrew its communist government in 1989, its economy was in shambles. There was very little money for services, infrastructure, or economic development. Yet President Václav Havel, and I'm sure I butchered his first name, chose to spend millions of dollars, ultimately, to refurbish the Obecny Dome, which is really a concert hall. Wow. A concert hall? When there are so many other dire needs in the newly independent Czechoslovakia? Well, the Obecny Dome was erected in the early years of the 20th century and formally opened in 1912. It was built and furnished in the Art Nouveau style. Its architecture, details, ornament, and decoration represent the work of nearly every leading Czech artist of the time. Okay, it's becoming a little bit more clear, but still, how economic need in that country. The building serves as a national symbol. In 1918, the independence of Czechoslovakia was formally proclaimed from its steps. During 40 years of communist rule, the Obecki Dom, like most of the rest of Prague, was neglected and allowed to deteriorate. Hollow saw the restoration of the building as fundamental to the revival of the nation, and the nation agreed. There were few complaints about the money spent to return this remarkable concert hall and gathering place to its former glory. It signified that the country was once again free and in control of its own destiny. So structures like this are very powerful, powerful to people, just as ideas are, just as stories are. There we go. Obviously, they can protect and preserve a heritage, a history of an area. One of the things that I tell my students every year, the students I have for the first time, so seventh graders in this case, I try to explain why they're studying history. Because quite a few of them come in and say, why do we have to do this? I'm never going to use this again in my life. Really? I then pull a screwdriver out of my desk. And I do a little homework beforehand to get to know some of the personalities. Not all of these students are completely unknown to me. And I ask them this question. Or I walk up to a particular student and ask this question. If I hand you this screwdriver right now and tell you to go walk over to the nearest electrical outlet and jam that screwdriver into the electrical outlet, would you do it? And of course, because I think, well, because some seventh grade boys in particular might just say, yeah! So this handpicked student says, no, why would I do that? That's stupid. How do you know that? Because I'll get electrocuted. How do you know that? And ultimately it comes down to experience. History is the story of human experience. We don't reinvent the wheel at every turn, thank goodness, because of history. We have learned something from the experience of our ancestors. That's true on a community level as well as a personal level. And historic preservation allows that history to be disseminated to another generation. It also establishes the identity of an area and fosters civic beauty. Areas that were neglected get maintenance, are attended to on a regular basis. That can only help local beauty. They bolster community pride. Last year, I believe it was last year, I gave my all the talks run together after a while. I believe it was last year, I gave a talk on Horatio Ames. Those of us who live over in the Amesville section of Salisbury take great pride in the fact that at one time there was an immense ironworks in our midst. Our little hamlet exists primarily because of this ironworks. The ironworks doesn't exist anymore, but the story's still there. The story of what hardworking people did to build a community. That's still there. We're very proud of that. And believe it or not, there are also economic benefits to historic preservation. It has been noted in several different studies that I read that they can actually stabilize property values by reducing the number of neglected properties in a particular community and also reducing the chance of reckless, mindless development. in other areas, particularly urban areas, there are even more economic benefits. They can provide for an efficient use of resources. If you recycle an old building, generally speaking, you might be looking at a more sturdily built structure. You might be looking at recycling of materials. You wouldn't have to necessarily bring in, create new materials in order to build buildings or to create space. It also can change a neighborhood. Any of you who knows anything about MassMoCA, the Massachusetts Museum of Contemporary Art in North Adams, they took an old, I believe it was a textile printing mill, where the company had gone bankrupt or moved its operation overseas. It was the primary employer in North Adams, and now it was gone. What are you going to do? Well, some very enterprising people turned it into a world-class museum. And I believe it's the world's largest museum of contemporary art. And it changed the momentum of a neighborhood, downtown North Adams, which was in rapid decline during those years, and during the 1960s in particular. Turned things around. North Adams is still having a rough time. As a Rust Belt city. But it was stabilized. More people are coming there now. They're coming to the area, getting hotel rooms, going to the local restaurants. So it's really, it can change the environment of a neighborhood. And it can be a good investment. There are various different tax incentives to reuse historic material and to preserve historic structures. Okay. Obviously, it's not all good. There are definitely problems. One problem is blind use. About 4 years ago, there was a situation in Miami where a neighborhood that had been built in the 1930s with a very specific type of structure as homes, it was a residential area, had changed over time. Fewer of those structures were being used as residences, many more being used as businesses. But a historic preservation group identified those structures as being unique to Miami, unique to the time. And so they endeavored to try and place all of those structures in a historic trust. The business owners were outraged because those structures ultimately were inappropriate to their business activities. And by having them become historically preserved structures, there was little they could do to alter them, to be more suited to the business activities that were there. And ultimately, in Miami at least, it produced sprawl, because businesses who could no longer conduct their business in those structures were forced to move outside of the city, or certainly outside of that neighborhood, to conduct their business. There are a lot of people, a lot of historic preservationists, who would argue against the idea that it contributes to sprawl, because if you reuse a historic structure, they're not having to relocate elsewhere. But in this case, in Miami, it was a problem. Another problem is that of the hidden agenda. Sometimes historic preservationists can be overzealous, as it appears they were in Miami. In other cases, it may not be historic preservation that people are actually after. Technology is great when it works, huh? There we go. You've got potential conflict between over public versus private ownership. There are a lot of libertarians in our country who believe that there should be no restrictions, government should put no restrictions on one's liberty, particularly what one does with one's private property. But as with those business owners in Miami, you have a historic district commission or some other group that comes in and tells them how their property is to be used, that's going to create conflict. Gee, you think there are political concerns in some of these areas? Absolutely. You have a developer who is well known to have a certain political view, and you have community advocates who are dead set against that particular developer. They sometimes have been known to use historic preservation laws to restrict what that developer does. Not because the project itself is bad, but because they have differences with the political agenda of the developer. And there are other, obviously other examples of political concerns. As well as design concerns. If someone, if a developer posts a proposal to develop a neighborhood that has certain historic preservation restrictions on it, anybody who has a problem with any aspect of the design can block it. There isn't necessarily a vote to try and establish consensus. Okay, so what does that have to do with here? Well, just across the river, there, as many of you know, is the dam that creates hydroelectric power through the First Light Power Generation Company. It was built in 1914. There is a boat launch right at that dam, with a little park connected to the Appalachian Trail and to a scenic overlook that if you've never been to when the falls are running, you've missed something rather dramatic, because it's an incredible place when the falls are running. It's also very historic because that location is where the Ames Ironworks once stood. This is the Salisbury side of the river with these structures. This is the Falls Village side of the river, the tracks for the Housatonic Railroad Company right there. And as you can see, in Minton, the day that this picture was taken, there was a railroad bridge, a spur, that went from the eastern shore of the Housatonic across to the western shore to bring railroad cars to the ironworks, and then later on to the shops of the Housatonic Railroad Company. None of these structures exist today. In fact, the thing that has lasted all these years, right here, the tracks. I don't know when they were replaced last, but that rail bed is still the one that's used today. Okay, big deal. Well, it was a big deal, because the Housatonic, or the Ames Ironworks, had a very colorful history. And I went into it last year when I spoke about Horatio Ames. And I know this is kind of small, but Horatio's right here. He's a very big man. Tough to see compared to all these other workers, but he towers above them. And right here is a cannon that he was very famous, or even you probably should say infamous for. At the time that cannon was developed, it was the most powerful in the world. It was developed during the early years of the Civil War, and it could fire a 125-pound projectile over 5 miles. Remarkable. made right at this ironworks right here. But it was not the only thing that was produced. They produced all manner of iron goods, including railroad wheels. And some of you already know that the railroad wheels that were cast in our area from Salisbury ore were some of the most durable railroad wheels that could be purchased in the late 19th and early 20th century. This is an overview, a map rather, from 1899. And by 1899, the ironworks was gone. It had gone into bankruptcy, primarily due to mismanagement. And the workshops and the furnace and the forges that were here were purchased by the Canaan Railroad Company. And you can see, the railroad yard here. Here's where the covered bridge, the spur that comes off of the eastern side of the river. And as you can see, there's a whole little community that's arisen there. Sugar Hill Road today contains a number of different structures that were created by the Ames Company to house its skilled workers. And as you can see, the railroad company used those as incentive as well and developed them even further. This little road here no longer exists across the river, but obviously there were housing there as well. Ooh, that one's tough to see. You can see a lot better sitting at a computer. This is a Google Earth satellite shot of the area. And although it's just tough to see in this room, here's the river with the dam right here. Here is River Road. And right in here, actually this is Dublin Road over here. Right over here is, okay, so that's the area. Although it's tough to see, it's now completely woodland. And it's owned by the power company. A little over 20 years ago, an effort was begun to try and preserve the historic nature of that space. There are no buildings left. They were all demolished right before 1914's building of the dam by the Hartford, what was then called the Hartford Electric Company. But it was thought to be worth preserving, worth interpreting, for the reasons I've stated already. But we'll state them again. There's an industrial heritage to that property. Over 800 workers were there at its peak. There's an immigration heritage as well. I did a talk last fall about, no, actually back in the spring, about Irish immigration to this area. The Ames Ironworks was a major magnet for migration to this area, particularly at first by Irish immigrants. In fact, what's now called Dublin Road got its name from the Irish immigrants that lived there. They lived across the river in Falls Village in ramshackle structures that no longer exist. But because it was so full of these Irish immigrants, it was renamed Dublin Road. I would guess that the Roman Catholic Church would have come to this area anyway, but it was the catalyst of Irish immigration to this area that brought it here that much more quickly. And the very first Catholic church that was established in the northwest corner was established across in Falls Village, St. Patrick's, obviously named. There's an innovation heritage there as well. Horatio Ames may have been a lousy manager, but he was quite an inventor. He came up with new methods of huddling, which means collecting, and I'm going to misstate how this works, but it's a way of collecting together the molten ore to help force out the impurities, thereby making the cast iron stronger. But Horatio Ames also came up in association with a man named, I believe his name was John Danvers, in a new method for creating large artillery pieces like the one I showed you in that photograph. Instead of casting them all in one piece, the problem being that if there are holes in the cast, the bigger the cast, the greater chance for holes. You have holes in the integrity of a cannon barrel, you're going to have problems. Well, Ames and Danvers came up with a way of welding iron donuts together, thereby allowing cannons with greater, I believe the term is muzzle velocity, and greater power to withstand the larger explosive charges that they were trying to put into these devices. And quite frankly, it adds an attraction to a town park. Actually, it's not a town park because it's private property. But it's an attractive area anyway. And if you enhance it by putting in a historically interpretive area, it's going to enhance it. A group called the Tri-Corners History Council, which ultimately, it's not a direct correlation, but it ultimately became the Upper Housatonic National Heritage Corridor. Together with what was then Connecticut Light and Power, put together this park over 20 years ago. And it includes an introductory sign, which I'll show you in just a moment, as well as interpretive markers. We used it during the years that the Falls Village Historical Festival took place. We've also conducted tours, walking tours of the trail under the auspices of the Upper Housatonic National Heritage Board. So it's definitely getting some use. It definitely has a community value. But it's fallen into some disrepair. As you can see, it's not always treated very well. There's a pair of jeans hanging from the corner here, waiting to dry. The power company does a good job most of the time of picking up the trash. They put a trash can there. That's always good. But it needs a little work. For example, well, it's tough to see in this light. There's some graffiti that has been etched into the wood below the introductory signs. The whole thing needs a paint job, some just regular maintenance work. This is an example of one of the interpretive signs. They are spaced around strategic locations along the trail. As you can see, 20 years of wear has taken its toll. On top of that, there's this piece of, I guess it's lucite or some other hard plastic, with a sign like this. Now, the sign was well conceived because it's not on paper or any other medium that could deteriorate with the weather. Instead, this is on metal. And they printed onto metal. And as you can see, through the years, mold, and algae, various different plant materials have started to grow there. It needs to be cleaned. All of them do. trail looks like today, as you can see, it's a little overgrown. In one case here, this is the root ball of a tree that fell over about 3 years ago. And there's a huge hole right on the trail itself that needs to be dealt with, so that people who have some walking difficulties can get through without falling over. And as you can see, it's pretty overgrown too. This is one of the interpretive signs. Can you find it? Completely overgrown, and it's tough in this particular location because this location marks the spot which looks out towards the only remnant, the only visible remnant of the buildings that used to be there. You can see a brick wall that is part of a larger rock face, but you can't see that today because all of this surrounds it. And this particular interpretive sign looks out on the area where the railroad turntable once stood during the days of the Housatonic Railroad, but you can't see. So, part of, as I said, this 8th grade project is really a call to action. We want to get 8th graders to make a difference, not just by telling people what's wrong, but by actually trying to change things. So this is my call to action, and I've already begun this effort. First Light, in this case, is really good to work with. The folks who work there, many of them have been there through all the different progressions of power companies and ownerships. Some of them have been there for a long, long time. They understand the historical importance of that trail, as well as the community importance of that trail. And they've already begun seeking to find a contractor who can come in and clean it up, as far as the fallen trees, cutting back the vegetation so that we could see some of the views and some of the interpretive signs. But it's going to take more than that. Not a lot, it's not a huge project. But for me, it's important because it's in my neighborhood and it celebrates a history that I've become very familiar with, the history of the Ames Iron Works. So I'm working with the Salisbury Association Historical Society, and I've begun to seek grants from a number of different groups, including the Department of Environment. This is a state department here. Now I'm not going to remember what all the letters stand for, but it doesn't matter. But there are lots of, there is money out there to be used for a project like this. We're not going to want it, I don't think, unless they all turn me down, which I doubt. Because I'm not going to be asking for much money. So, I'm hoping that by the fall, you'll be able to walk up there and really enjoy the trail as it was meant to be. To really interpret what once went on in that space. And then the final piece of the puzzle, what about you? What's your area of passion? Let's promote it. Our local historical societies and land trusts are always in need of people. Any of you who have any knowledge of the Salisbury Association, or have seen any of the recent exhibits that the Salisbury Association Historical Society has created, probably know that the burden of creating those exhibits has essentially fallen on one or two, sometimes a small handful of people. One of the primary people is in our midst today. And she will tell you that, yeah, it's been a lot of fun, but it's been a lot of work as well. And she'll tell you she's received a lot of help, but not as much help as she could have received. Our local historical societies and land trusts need you. They need your knowledge. They need your effort. And I know I'm speaking on behalf of the Falls Village Historical Society, Falls Village Canaan Historical Society, when I say that, as well as the Salisbury Association.
We need you.
Oh, he's going so well there.
Just a little.
Come on.
But it doesn't have to be in a historical society.
Our kids don't need enough nonfiction. It's on our curriculum. Maybe we can have more. Each of our schools in Region 1 has a Read Aloud Day. Usually they need the books for you. But maybe you can make a phone call to an English or a literature teacher that you know, or you can get used to, and offer to read nonfiction. Tell some of the stories of our country or our community. And kids who love stories will eat it up. Here's a simple one. Take your family to a historic site that you know about. I remember when I was growing up, I gained my great love of history from my mother, because when we used to go to museums, yeah, I was a typical adolescent boy. I didn't want to stand there and read all the little placards. But my mother had done her homework ahead of time. She knew something about the place that we would visit, and she started to tell stories. And that made it come alive. You can do that too. I know this is a little bit ambitious, but I know that there are some of you who are very good writers. There are lots of different publications that are just dying to have contributors. One of the magazines here in Connecticut is called Connecticut Explored. It used to be called the Hog River Journal. They're always looking for contributors to that magazine. Anything that has to do with Connecticut history. But ultimately, and here is my thesis, ties back into the 8th grade project. Historic preservation has psychological and economic importance for all communities. Preservation cannot occur without participation. Please participate. Thank you very much.
We did leave some time for questions. I see it worked, Jeremy.
Well, no, actually, it was pretty wise. Judy?
Just to clarify a little bit on the Ames Trail up there, it was actually the Falls Village Canaan Historical Society and the Falls Village Economic Development Commission that put that in.
Thank you!
And we have all those photographs in our collection, so when those signs are ready to be done, we have that all ready to go. The signs themselves were built by the Boag Department down at high school.
The stands?
The stands.
Okay.
And they were paid for by the Salisbury Association. CLMP at that time was very good about maintaining it, but they have cut back on their outdoor crew. And
right.
I think that's why it's gotten to disappear so much.
I think that's true too. I spoke with Rick Harmon yesterday, the day before, and he told me that as far as he knows, there's already an effort in the works to bring in somebody to try and clean up some of the neglect that has occurred over the past few years.
We and Mark was down initially, they dug, you could have seen what that place looked like before they
put
the trail, and it was so overgrown. And they just went in and cleared these nice white paths. They all had plastic underneath so that the leaves wouldn't come through, but eventually they had it because of lack of care. But they really.
And they created a beautiful mound that they used as a flower bed for a long time.
And
they've replaced that with, actually, I think what they replaced with makes sense, a picnic bench.
Well, the shrubs that they planted there were stolen.
Oh!
Dug right out and stolen. Yeah. But they were so great initially. And I know after a couple of floods, some of those stands had to have
I'm hoping that they won't have to be replaced simply clean.
They did that before, and it came out beautiful.
Yeah, I think
they chose that medium. Yeah. So Judy, I guess I'll be seeing you in the next few weeks. Yes, sir.
What happened to St. Patrick's Church? And if I want to walk on this trail, where do I pick it up initially?
It's a nice trail because it's a loop. And if you go to the Salisbury side of the river, which these days and for the next few years is more difficult than you can imagine, and go up north of Sugar Hill Road, about a quarter mile north of Sugar Hill Road on River Road, there is a large dirt parking area. Where
beaches?
No, it's really a boat launch. Clark Outdoors sends people up river from that spot. So there's a large area, it's right at the dam. You can take a look at the top of the falls. And on the northern edge of the parking area is where that first big sign that had the sort of roof over it, that's where that is. And the trail basically just loops around. It's about a quarter mile trail. And once you see the entrance to it, it's pretty evident. Mm-hmm.
The Appalachian Trail comes in above
that. The Appalachian Trail goes through just south of the parking lot. It crosses River Road and goes up Prospect Mountain, literally, I'm going to say, 10 yards south of the parking lot. As far as St. Patrick's is concerned, St. Patrick's, the structure itself, the chapel itself still exists, but it is now a private home. It essentially went the way of demographic changes here in the northwest corner. When the Ames Iron Works bankrupt, the Irish immigrants who were here, many of whom were unskilled, had to find new work, and they tended to migrate to the iron mines over in Salisbury, essentially shifting the focus of Roman Catholicism here in the northwest corner from Falls Village to Lakeville, and ultimately established the St. Mary Parish as the focus of the parish. The parish itself used to include Falls Village because that was its origin, but then it moved here. The St. Patrick's Chapel was administered by St. Joseph's up in North Canaan for a long, long time, and then just became too expensive to hold and maintain as a separate location. The number of congregants who would go to Mass at St. Patrick's dwindled with every year, and just became cost ineffective to keep. And the Archdiocese sold the property, I want to say, 5 years ago or so, maybe longer than that. Yes?
There was an earlier St. Patrick's Church, I think, that Mr. Chinati can tell you.
Yes.
In Falls Village, just down from their house.
Right on Warren Turnpike, correct?
Our house was the rectory.
Oh, was it really?
The first Catholic Church between Norwalk and Pittsgate.
Oh.
The foundation is just down the road.
Oh, that's very cool. And they did preserve the windows. And I believe I heard that the windows that were the windows that were transferred to the second chapel, which was over on, what was that, BB Hill Road, are now at St. Joseph's. Is that correct? Of it. But yeah, when they demolished all of the buildings
that were part of the Eames Ironworks and then later the railroad shops. They also blew up the Little Falls, which was, you're right, that was where the water wheel, the power, the forges, and the hammers was located. Yeah, it's too bad. Occasionally, when the water's low, you can still see the rocks that were part of the Little Falls. And when the water's low, even though you don't get the feeling of the falls, you can also see the post that was the pivot point, I guess you'd call it, on the old railroad turntable that was there. It was very cool to see. Anyone else? Well, thank you so much for coming out on a hot morning. And thanks for helping me to fulfill my 8th grade project requirements.